Hi, and welcome to One of My Contemporary. I'm Kathy McCreese. Before we start our adventure walking through the gallery with Sonia, I do want to acknowledge our sponsors for the exhibition, the John and Robin Horn Foundation, Robin Ballinger, and Friends of Fiber Arts International. So we are so excited to have Sonia in town. She's been here a couple days and been toured around from place to place, and hopefully she's gotten a little taste of Tulsa. So we'll just introduce her, and then she'll walk you through. Sonia is the recipient of a Distinguished Research Fellowship at the School of Arts at Virginia Commonwealth University. From 2006 to 2017, she served as chair for the Craft Materials Studies Department. In 2016, she was awarded a university-wide Distinguished Scholars Award. She earned an MFA from Cranbrook Academy of Art and was honored with their Distinguished Alumni Award in 2011. Her work has been exhibited in more than 350 museums and galleries in the Americas, Africa, Asia, Europe, and Australia. She is the recipient of numerous distinguished prizes, fellowships, and awards, including the Art Prize Grand Jurors Award, and most recently, an Anonymous Was a Woman Award. She is currently a visiting artist in residence at Amherst College. Her work has been reviewed in several publications, including the New York Times, the Philadelphia Inquirer, Italian Vogue, Los Angeles Times, Hyperallergic, Mother Jones, and Huffington Post. You will find her many honors detailed in the catalog. If you don't have one, they're on the counter up there. Welcome, Sonia. We are looking forward to your talk.
Thank you. Can you all hear me? Normally I would do this without a mic, but I'm getting over a little bit of a cold, and I don't want you to lose any words should I say something that makes you think you have a question or something like that. But you can all hear me, right? I'm so grateful to be here in Tulsa. So I'm grateful to Cookie, I'm grateful to all of you at 108 Contemporary. It's good to see old friends from the East Coast, sort of. It's really, really lovely for me to be here. My only regret, and I've been saying this, is that my partner in crime is not here with me. We bookended this. So Joyce Scott, who is someone who I've known for 25 years, oh my gosh, I just realized that's half my life. I've known Joyce Scott for half my life. I'm just going to start. I can only say that this year. So I'm happy to have her present with us through the quality of her work and the presence of her work. We've been thinking about some of the same materials for a long time, drawing from some of the same sources, and have been old friends in long conversations. So I'm happy to have you witness this dialogue of our conversation through this show, Both Sides Now. So it's my honor to spend a little bit of time with you today to tell you a little bit about the work, but I'm also hoping that this thing that's happening, where you're all acting like I need a lot of space, we'll bridge this very quickly, and I'm hoping that we'll get to a sort of dialogical part of this gallery talk. And the reason for that is really, really selfish. Really selfish. I travel very light. Is this true? Like most times people say, so do we need to pick up your bags now? I say, no, this is it. I travel very, very light. Because the thing that I really like to pack is the conversations and the questions. Those are the generative things that come back to me with my studio, not things. They're your ideas, the things that surprise you about the show or challenge you, the things that don't quite make sense, your personal readings on the show that might not match with my intentions as an artist. All of those things are the stuff that come back to me, come back with me. They don't take up any room in the suitcase. They come back with me, and they become the generative material for the next body of work. So you can see why this is very selfish of me, right? Your reflections reside in my next body of work. You're all in my studio with me and you don't even know it. Okay, so I want to tell you a couple of things about a couple of pieces and also just give you some guiding principles for some things that I've been thinking about. So just as a beginning, I've been reading a lot of James Baldwin all of my life, but recently I've been rereading a lot of James Baldwin. And there's this quotation that he has where he says that the purpose of art is to lay bare the questions hidden in the answers. The purpose of art is to lay bare the questions hidden in the answers. So it already in that makes you think about art as being this kind of dialogue, right? He's implying that there are questions and answers in the work. So as I'm telling you about my work, I really don't want this to be an, oh, I didn't see that, I didn't think about that. When I make work, it's drawing together lots of different things, but as soon as it goes out into the world, it belongs to all of you, right? And whether they're in places that we touch, you say, oh, I saw that in the work, or I didn't see that, that's how full the work can be in terms of absorbing all of us, right? There's room for everybody in the artwork. I like to think that the objects that I make are like sponges. They can absorb all of our stories. Okay, so I'm gonna start right here, because I think it's always pretty wise to, is it your phone?
Yeah.
Okay, you got this.
Yeah. I was like, as long as it's not my phone, which is in the office, so. Is that loud, we'd be in trouble. So I always think it's wise to start with a little bit to talk about ancestry. Mostly when I'm making work, I'm thinking about very personal stories and then connecting those personal stories, hopefully, to a wider audience. So this piece, which is called the McCarty Tartan, looks like a tartan, right? You hear that it's a McCarty tartan, you think, oh, well, that must be the plaid that is the McCarty tartan. Okay, pretty straightforward, you guys get that. Most of you have seen these Scottish plaids, right? So the McCarty tartan is my family's tartan. My family is, my mother is Jamaican, my father was from Trinidad and first generation American. Born and raised in Washington, D.C. The Jamaican side of my family, McCarty, by the way, is my mother's maiden name, and not a slave name, but a family name. So in 1870, my great-grandfather and my great-grandmother got married, and they could get married then. There were more black women in Jamaica than there were white women, so it would have been ridiculous for them not to allow people to marry. But also emancipation happened a lot earlier in the Caribbean, specifically in Jamaica, than it did in the United States of America. And clearly, when we think about the case of the Lovings, right? That was the 70s. That was 1970. Like, it was 100 years later in Virginia, where I live now, where a black woman and a white man could get married. 100 years earlier, that's my great-grandparents, right? And here I am today. So, Alexander McCarty, from the Highlands of Scotland. His family moved to Jamaica. They moved to Jamaica because, like many people, from Britain was everywhere. Jamaica was Britain, right? His family moved there because of the main cash crop, which was? And sugarcane is what this is made out of. So it would be ordinarily be made out of Scottish wool from the Highlands of Scotland, but instead it's made out of bagasse. Bagasse is what is left when you squeeze out all of the sugar cane. It's usually the waste material. It's what used to be thrown away. But now we live in a much more green era, so people have taken that sugar cane and they've turned it into a rayon-like fiber. When I became aware of that, I said, I can use that fiber for something to talk about both sides now, right? Say it white and black, European and African. Caribbean and American, right? Scottish and sugarcane, right? You know? Or wool and rayon, you know? Both sides now. What lays on the cloth, by the way, is about 15 feet long. It was hand-dyed to make it the colors of the Jamaican tartan, of my family tartan. I made it with the intention of turning it into an artwork. I was going to do these formal portraits of people in my family who live around the world, right? And they really do live around the world. They live in Ghana, they live in the UK, they live in Jamaica, the Caribbean, they live in the US, they live all over the world. And I thought, I'm going to write a grant, and I'm going to travel around the world, and I'm going to take this piece of cloth with me. There's not going to be anything else in the luggage because I travel light. It's just going to be this piece of cloth and some undies, you know, and be good to go. Maybe some soap, I don't know. And I'm going to take these formal portraits of my family. Well, 2 years ago, I had one of my aunts passed away, and I knew that many of my family members were going to be gathered there at the funeral. And so what I did was I brought this piece of cloth, tucked in my luggage. It was essentially all that I brought, plus the little dress that I was wearing to the funeral. And I thought, I'm going to take it out at some point, and I'm going to see if this is right, you know, if I can sort of impose art into this family gathering. Is that right or not right? You know. So what I did is I carried it, I took it out as it repassed, and my family descended on this cloth in a way that I wish I had a photograph to show you. There is not a single formal portrait. My family, they would gather in groups of like 5, 3 to 10 to 12, and wrap themselves in this cloth. I wasn't making an art piece, I was making an heirloom. What's on the cloth is the first time I went to West Africa, the first time I went to the continent of Africa, I went to West Africa, Cote d'Ivoire. And this clay pot you see here, it was made by a woman in Cote d'Ivoire, the Baoulé people. And in it is hand-spun cotton that is dyed in indigo. So cotton from the earth there, dyed from the dyes there. And then this little ceramic plate you see here that has earth on it has the earth from my family's homestead. How many of you are my Scottish brethren? Yeah, see? So we're all connected, right? Any Jamaicans in the house by chance? No, I'm looking at the crowd, I didn't think so, but I knew I'd get some Scots in there. Okay, so you can see how that's a very personal story, but there's a way that you can connect to the work, right? Because you see it, you see it's a tartan, everybody kind of knows what a tartan is, right? And switching the materiality there as a kind of strategy to bringing two different heritages of mine together. How many of you had the chance to listen to this piece? Did anybody get the chance? A couple of you? So my friend who I just met, what did you hear? Do you remember what you heard?
It's a reenactment of Civil War battle or something?
Yeah, it is, so that's close. It's not a reenactment. Civil War is correct, battle is correct. So I had the opportunity to get, I guess this was about 5 or 6 years ago now, the Smithsonian has these great research grants specifically for artists. So I was at the Smithsonian Artist Research Fellowship, and while I was there, I unearthed some research that resulted in two pieces that are in this show. This one, and the one at the far end of the gallery, which we'll get to at some point. This piece is called The Rebel Yell. That is the name of the roller coaster. The roller coaster is a roller coaster that I rode in the 70s. We all wanted to be on this roller coaster. It's still one of these roller coasters that people are very proud of because it's a wooden roller coaster. So architecturally, that's a kind of interesting thing. My immigrant parents didn't think anything of taking their kids, all these brown and beige kids, packed us up in a car in the 70s and took us down to King's Dominion, which is just outside of where I live now, a few minutes from Richmond. And we were all going to get on the ride at the time, which was the Rebel Yell. Nobody thought about what the Rebel Yell meant. The Rebel Yell is the battle cry of the Confederate soldiers. So this is a scale model.
of the roller coaster, obviously. It still is a ride that one can get on. And then there was a dance party. So I have fond memories of this roller coaster that is named for the battle cry of the Confederate soldiers. I have fond memories of this roller coaster because as a kid, I had fun on this roller coaster because history can be insidious like that. We were encouraged to yell right in this part so you could get the reverberation. I don't remember if we were encouraged to actually do the rebel yell, but you'll notice that the cars are red and blue, and they raced against each other. One was supposed to be the north, one was supposed to be the south. We didn't think anything of that. I got my first kiss in the 70s from one of those brown kids. After riding this roller coaster, I have fond memories of essentially a monument that was built to the Confederate soldiers and their battle cry. So to problematize that, I took archival recordings of Confederate soldiers doing the battle cry. So they're not, it's a reenactment in the sense that it's not them giving the battle cry at the Civil War. These are people who were veterans of the Civil War. So while this is a cloth that is bringing together two heritages in a way that, you know, reside in who I am today, this is a sculpture that is bringing together two parts of our history. One that is just popular culture fun stuff, right? The 1970s, everybody is watching The Dukes of Hazzard. And the problems of our history as well. Both sides now. So this is why we started on this side, on this side of this exhibition. But I'd like to move us through some other pieces. So let's see. Where shall we go next? Anybody want to hear something specific about a piece? You get to choose.
The poems.
Yeah.
The poems.
Yes,
that is my work.
We'll go this way. You guys can all still hear me, right? So these columns, because there are a couple of columns, but these columns, whoever said the columns, you meant this piece? Yes, you meant this one. Yeah. I just have to look up the names of my artwork. Yeah, that's choices. Oh, it's right there. Can't take comb cloth. Yeah, well, there's some logic there. Okay. So I was trained as a textile artist, so I'm always thinking about textiles. One of the ways of making a textile is taking any small thing and putting it into multiples and making it into something pliable. You don't get to do this because you just don't. But I do because I made it. But it is pliable, right? So it's not a rigid piece. And the piece is referring to Kente cloth, which is West African cloth. When I first learned how to weave, that same trip, the first time I went to West Africa and went to the Côte d'Ivoire, or the Ivory Coast, is the first time that I wove on a long strip woven loom. And it's a strip woven loom, so they're the same kind of looms that make Kente cloth. So, in this piece, I have been working with combs for a long time. And let's see, this is from 2011, so I've been making, I don't remember, what year is this from, anybody? Do you remember?
Yeah.
I don't remember either, so you're off though. It might be later than 2011. But I've been working with combs since about 2004. I think that's the first piece that I made with combs. And the reason I started working with combs, which is a question that people often ask,
Oh, no, this piece is from 2014. I just remember the residency that I made it in. So it's from 2014. The reason I started working with Combs is that a long time ago, a friend of mine by the name of Bill Gaskins, who's a professor at Cornell University, where's my Cornell friend? Oh, there you are. Let me try it over you. Right. So I have a friend who teaches, and I think you were there at the same time. But Bill Gaskins is a photographer, and at some point we lived in Kansas City, Missouri, and that's where we met. And Bill had a show of photographs that he did of African American people and their fantastic hairstyles. And I apologize for having relatively boring hair for you today. but I did do this for you. And I was making works that were like weeks that approximated hairstyles, that very elaborate hairstyles that I had as a child that I was given by the, I grew up in DC, so the people across the street from me happened to be the ambassador's family from Dahomey, Benin. It was a family of 14. They used to do our hair, my sister and me, they used to do our hair in the most fabulous sculptural hairstyles. And I still miss that. So I was making work that was trying to remember those hairstyles that I had as a child. Bill Gaskins had made these photographs of African-American hairstyles. Bill is also a cultural critic and a curator and a writer, and mainly a writer and a photographer. And he wrote about my work that hairdressing was a primordial textile art form. And he wrote that in 1996, and it stayed with me for years, still stays with me. So you can see how combs connect textiles and hairdressing, right? So when I first started working with combs, people said to me, oh, she's left textiles, she's now working with plastic. And I thought, they don't understand. Combs are part of textiles too. I mean, you can't do anything on a loom without something that's like a comb. So they become the thing that connect the two. The other thing that happened in working with combs for a long time is that I was working with these black plastic pocket combs, which are, you know, dense in terms of they don't have much color or anything like that. So I wanted to insert color in them. And so my way of inserting color was by thread wrapping the back of the combs and punctuating this cloth as if it is like kente cloth, and as if it has a rhythm of jazz, a sort of syncopated beat. Are there any other questions about this piece?
How do you connect them?
They're drilled, and closely you'll see that they're drilled, and you can see that they're wire and beads running through it. You can't touch it like I did, but you can get it.
So do you wrap before you connect, or?
Yes. Uh-huh. Yeah, it would be impossible to do it the other way. So the composition is, you know, made up weaving. It's like a weaving, you know, I have to connect this comb to this comb and decide where I want the color as I'm going along. And then when I come back this way, then another row gets attached to these two, and this row, and then this row. Does that make sense? Essentially, I turn the combs into beads, because anything that has a hole in it is a bead, you know, by definition, a workable definition. So I turn the combs into beads. I've been making a lot of work with beads, too. That's one of the ways that Joyce and I connected. Now, I didn't put that many beaded works in this show, because when you're showing with Lee Joyce Scott, we bead in very, very different ways. Like, Joyce is all about, we're talking about jazz. Joyce is all about the jazz in her bead work. When we bead together, I'll start something and it won't be quite right and I'll leave it to the side and Joyce picks it up and puts it in her work. Because, you know, no child should be left behind, you know? She just like scoops it up and makes it part, right? And I'm like rejecting it and feeling awful that I've rejected it. Like, didn't quite right work out. She's like, no, I can be scooped up and made part of it at home. Anyway, what's the next piece of you should move to? The violin goes. Okay, so we'll go to another sound piece. That's this piece over here, following here. I'm gonna have to split the audience a little bit so some of you can come on this side. How many of you had the opportunity to listen to this piece?
Anybody? A couple of you? Let me tell you what you'll hear, for those of you who have not listened to the piece. Well, let me describe the piece a little bit. So, since I'm on this music theme, I should tell you that in 1986, I fell deeply, madly in love. So in love that, like a passionate kind of love that you have at 19. The person I fell deeply and madly in love with was 17, so not actually legal. and that person, I proposed to that person at 19. I said, we should get married. And though this person that I was deeply madly in love with was 2 years younger than me, this person also is an old soul and a little wiser, certainly at this period in our lives, was a little wiser and said, I'm 17. One of those rare moments when a married couple can both be right. He was right. We should not have gotten married then. We've been happily married for 21 years, and he is, we got married much later. and my husband is a phenomenal jazz musician. Now I'm biased, right? Because I told you I'm deeply, madly in love, but other people clap loudly when he plays. So he's a clarinetist. And we met in college, and he was very young and bright. And so he was a freshman when I was a sophomore, and I scouted him out and said, you, me, together, later. But it took many, 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 many years after we've known each other before I actually put together the idea of hair and music in my work. So I've been working with hair for a long time, but hair and music didn't come about until there's a quote that I read by Maya Angelou, which I'm not going to remember right now, but it refers to, there's a part of it that says, my hair a hive of honeybees. So you just can imagine the sound of that. Daryl, my beloved, he for many years toured with another genius. You know, we're in the company of geniuses. Right? Joyce McGenius Scott. For those of you who don't understand that reference, you know she's a MacArthur Fellow, just won a MacArthur Fellowship. She should have won it like 20 years ago, so I'm pissed about that, but I'm very happy for her. I think she should have won it a long, long time ago. Anyway, but my husband for many years toured with Regina Carter, who is a genius jazz violinist. And Regina had gotten MacArthur probably about 6 or 7 years ago. And she was doing a recording session with my husband down in Richmond. And I had made these pieces, these violin bows, which I very logically rehaired. You know, violin bows have horse hair on them, and I rehaired them with human hair, right? This is not profundity. This is sort of art logic, right? But it was when I knew that Regina was coming to town that I thought, I wonder if she's going to be willing to put that genius reputation on the line and see if we can actually activate the sound of our ancestors through our DNA. Would these, in fact, make music? Beyond sound, would they actually, could she make music? Yeah, Regina was gay, right? And they were going to do a recording session anyway. So this violin bow is rehaired with a dreadlock made from my own hair. I've never had dreadlocks, so I saved my hair and I felted it into a dreadlock. So it rehaired, not restrung, everybody says restrung, rehaired. I was schooled, school you all. Rehaired that one. And then this one that has the braided hair with seemingly blonde hair, and I say seemingly because it's actually from an Asian woman's hair that has then been bleached blonde. This hair was free. This hair was so expensive. Which is, you know, something to be said if you think about that in and of itself. What Regina then did is that she recorded Lift Every Voice and Sing, popularly known as the Negro National Anthem, America the Beautiful, and the Star Spangled Banner. So two anthems and a popular American song. Three popular American songs. What you'll hear on the recording is Lift Every Voice and Sing played on the dreadlock rehaired with my hair, and simultaneously her recording of the Star Spangled Banner on the bow that's rehaired with a violet, with a straight blonde hair. So you'll hear those overlaid, two anthems being sung at once. Now what's interesting is it's not just a, say, a European-African proposition, because the Asian woman is also implied, so everybody's in it, right? And then there's also a recording of America the Beautiful as well, with those two, played by both bows, but the same song. So I'm going to take you maybe to, how are we doing for time? You guys tired of hearing me talk yet?
No?
No? Oh, okay.
The rest of your life, yeah.
Confederate flag of troops. So at Appomattox,
Lee took a dishcloth. He took a dishcloth that was woven in Richmond, Virginia, which is where I live now, and have lived for a dozen years. But it made its way to Appomattox, and it was a whitish enough cloth. Probably looked like this back in the day, and it's yellowed over time. So the one that's at the Smithsonian looks like this, but it probably looked more like this back in the day. And he took it to use as a flag of surrender. That flag then got cut in half, and half is at the Smithsonian. And the other half has been chopped up into lots of little pieces and belongs in some various private collections and some public museums. So the cloth that brought our nation together has been effectively deconstructed and not remembered. And the flag that brought our nation apart is still burned brightly in the retinas of our minds, right? So this is one action of me trying to do something about that. So remember this cloth, remember this cloth, remember this cloth, remember this cloth, right? History is about telling as many stories as we can tell. History is not just one story that gets told. History is about as many stories as can be told. It's possible from as many vantage points. So the, let's see, the last piece I think I'll share with you about No, I'm going to let you guys pick. What else do you want to hear about? You're right next to me and I can't hear you. What'd you say?
The Ellison book cover, Invisible Man.
The Ellison book cover, Invisible Man. Oh, yeah. There.
Invisible Man.
Yeah. What would you like to know about this?
Just curious what inspired it. Just interesting.
Okay, so I had to make a beaded piece. And I knew Joyce was not going to make a solid black beaded piece, so that was good. No, I also told her about this piece. So I'm thinking about this piece as being the beginning of a piece. I'm thinking about it as being a piece that talks about what is seen and what is not seen. Obviously, it's playing on the idea of an invisible man. What do you imagine might be inside of this? Oh, come on, people. It's not like you get an A or a B.
Bible?
Yeah, people, so that's an association that lots of people have, that it's like a Bible, right? Mm-hmm. I think it's the blackness and the size of it. Any other guesses what might be inside?
The inside is white, covering up, the black is finally covering up the white, yeah?
You think the inside,
no.
You know, you're talking?
Yeah, the inside of, is that what you asked, the inside of the black beaded?
Yeah, what's inside, what do you think is inside of here?
I'm not sure, but I could see the different colors being white inside and the black is outside.
For oh, white, I see what you're saying, like, yeah, like a more
and
symbolic
so it's not
thing.
Invisible anymore.
Yeah. This is the first I've shown the piece. And so there's an artist who is a friend who I greatly respect by the name of El Anatsui. If you're not familiar with his work, you probably know his work anyway. Those of you who are in who go to any museum. He makes these huge, huge, huge scale pieces that are made out of the liquor foil, bottle caps and that sort of thing, but they're huge. And they too become like cloth. In the same way that my little tiny Kente cloth piece, because his pieces are huge, become a kind of cloth. The first time I met Elle, we were both giving artist talks in Lexington, Kentucky. And he was giving a talk at the University of Kentucky, and I was giving a talk at a place called Transylvania University. And we both went to each other's talks. And I remember this distinctly. Elle said that a wall reveals more than it conceals. So it's why, I'm letting you know that, because that's what came to mind as I was asking you what this might, what might be in here. That your imagination is what is telling you what's in there, right? Mm-hmm. And so it reveals something about your inner self, like if we are walls, you know? You don't know what I'm thinking until I express it, right? That when you imagine what might be in there and you express what you're imagining, then it's revealing something beyond your wall, the wall of our selfhood. It is not a Bible. It is not a Bible. I'm curious, since you asked, what made you curious about this piece?
I actually didn't. I'm just a fan of Ellison.
Me too.
And his poems and stuff.
He's from
Oklahoma. He grew up in
Oklahoma. Yeah, I know. That too. His wife is here.
Yeah, I never really thought what was actually inside, just kind of, just set me on, a quest of what I might think was inside, what that might mean on top of the music band. So now I am really curious.
Well, and would it be different if you had the black on the bottom and the invisible man on the top?
It would be different.
Yeah.
It would be different.
Or if it was standing upright.
It would be different. Yeah. So all of those things, like, you see how you guys are helping me make my artwork? All of that right in there. If it was this, if it was that, all of those are considerations that I get to take home for free.
I kind of imagined it as sort of representing the story of the Invisible Man, how he removes himself from society and makes himself, completely invisible.
So, in one sense, a sort of illustration of what happens to that person.
Yeah.
Could be Pandora's box.
It's not
even Pandora's box.
It's like being invisible, but also being
invisible.
So, did you all hear that reading? That it's not accessible anymore to your eye, but still to your imagination, but I understand your point, it's not accessible, right? You've been very helpful. Are there any last pieces? Are there any last questions that you guys have?
You would have had if it wasn't lined up, but it was
I decided not to. I think it might be powerful. You really have been my test audience.
Pandora's box.
I have a question.
Yes.
You have this really beautiful precision about your work and an economy of, as artists, that's kind of our job to kind of take these big, complex ideas and messy concepts and sort of distill them. And I was just wondering if you could talk about, how you do that, what's your sort of process for taking these big ideas and kind of distilling them in such precise, perfect samples.
First of all, thank you. That felt like a compliment. I don't know if you meant it or not, but I'm taking it as a compliment. So thank you, Angie, right? Yeah, thank you, Angie. One of the things that I think I use as a kind of device or strategy is that I know that many of the things, if you sit with the work for a while, they'll unearth some unpleasantness. And that unpleasantness is something that I want people to be in conversation with. Not to say, art should be pretty and there's a little ugliness there, I don't want to look at the ugly. So I'm actually using kind of a precision, as you called it, but I would also say maybe a reliance on a kind of formalism that is familiar, so that people will come closer and maybe linger longer. Now, if they leave with, that was a cool beaded thing I saw, I'm okay with that. I'd like a little bit more, but I'm okay with that. But I don't want immediate repulsion. That's not what I'm looking for in my work. So in the same way that I, not in the same way, let me say this, in a parallel way that I was seduced by the Rebel Yell as a child and later thought about the problems of, it's the same sort of strategy that I'm wittingly using in my work.
to take something that seems like something familiar, something pleasant, and then say, okay, there's a little bit more here. And how do we unearth that? You know? It doesn't always work. So, you know, what's presented here, I'm hoping works. But the messy stuff is what I was just telling you that, like, I'm a visiting artist at my alma mater right now at Amherst College, and everybody keeps saying, we can't wait to see the body of work that you make after this year. And I'm like, I'm planning to spend this year making really awful, atrocious crap that nobody will ever see, so I can distill to something that might warrant the kind of compliment that you so graciously gave me. Other comments? Yes.
Yes, I loved your performance in New York, I think, of the deconstruction of the flag and the remains. And I'm wondering, well, I wish we could have reproduced that here, because I just think that was so moving. I'm wondering if you will ever use the yarn to reweave it into some other project.
So I have lots of answers to that question. Mm-hmm. So the first thing is, let me describe the piece so that people will know what we're talking about. In April of 2015, it was 150th anniversary of the end of the Civil War when this whole business at Appomattox happened, right? And 2013, 14, and 15, everybody with their iPhones or their phones on their cameras, this nation witnessed African-American people being shot for doing nothing.
Yeah.
And witnessed it. Now, it was in the news, but it is not news. This is a long, 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 long history, an ugly, ugly, ugly history in the United States of America. African American lives are not valued as much as European American lives. Mm-hmm. And there's a reason for that. It's deeply embedded into the old wood of this nation. So reflecting on that, those two things, I was trying to measure how far we had come since the end of the Civil War. And the first piece that I did was to completely take apart a cotton flag like this one, not dyed black, but a cotton Confederate battle flag, to its threads, with the help of my studio assistants. All praise be to studios. Lots of this work is here because of them. Very, very helpful hands and heads. So we took it down to, and that piece is called Unraveled, and that's what you have here. That's the first piece we made. We just took it down to its threads and segregated them, right? Red, white, and blue. Because we thought we might use them for something later. But what ended up happening instead is that's the end game, right? And I realized we're not there yet. So what is the work that it takes to undo that history? And I don't mean to undo the history, but to undo the damage that has been done in history. And that required, in my mind, the presence of other people, shoulder to shoulder with me, paired up, we're just using our hands, trying to undo this cloth. And 50 people were with me in June at that opening in Chelsea in New York. One at a time, you know, I was always there, and then someone would join me and they'd undo a thread or two or three threads, and a number of things happened. People would say, I didn't realize cloth was so complicated. Let's just insert history. I didn't realize history was so complicated. I didn't realize racism was so complicated. I didn't realize, you know what I mean? It's a metaphor, right? I didn't realize this was so complicated. It's kind of hard to take it apart just with your hand. Yeah, because these are the only tools we have, right? It's hard. When they would get it, some people would say, oh gosh, I was so satisfying to take out that thread. So satisfying to undo a little bit of the damage of this history. So satisfying to
undo the damage of racism. So that piece has never turned into a completely unraveled flag. The work is far too slow. Because I have to teach someone.
Sure.
I'm in dialogue with them. And we have precious little time together. You know, in 2 hours, I was 2 minutes per person, right? So it was 2 or 3 minutes per person. And we get through maybe half an inch. So we started with the idea that we would make maybe an American flag out of the threads of the unraveled, completely unraveled Confederate flag. But I never got to that piece because then the Charleston Massacre occurred. After that performance. I happened to be in Italy at the time, doing research. Woe is me, I was in Italy. And everybody was talking about the Confederate flag again, the Confederate battle flag again, as a symbol. And there was this moment where people said, we have to take them off the shelves, and da-da-da-da-da, and it's a symbol, so they get taken off the shelves. And, okay, and it's a symbol in my artwork too, but I'm about the racism and what's happening with the history. The symbol, right? I mean, not that I love the Confederate flag. I was really happy when it came down off of many of the places. It's the flag of a war that was lost. There's no reason to fly it. I mean, there's like no logical reason to fly this flag. Anyway, thank you for your question.
Great piece. So it's still, there is still plenty left to unravel?
Yes, and the piece actually, so the piece, so this is a behind the scenes part. The piece, that piece and this piece are in series. There are 5 of each of them.
Okay, so we could get you back to have that performance, to
yes,
continue
I'm actually
it.
Performing it twice this fall, once in, so it was in at Duke, at Ben Asher. I performed it there. That was the second time, then this fall, that show from Duke called Southern Accent, which is a fabulous show and I'm honored to be in it, is going to be at the Speed Art Museum in Kentucky, and I'll perform it there. And then the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts has just acquired one, and so I'll perform that piece. Each piece is different because as they are performed, the people who helped me, their names are attached to the piece.
Nice.
So the very first one is in a collection, and all the names of the people who helped me unravel it, even to the point that it got unraveled, their names are attached to it.
If I may, after we got to this point about the racism, recently I read a talk given by Condoleezza Rice, and she began it with, "This country was born with a birth defect." And after that hit me, then I realized how difficult it is genetically to get rid of a birth defect.
Yeah, it's not easy work that we have to do. But we have to do
it. Yeah, right, exactly.
I mean, our country is getting torn apart, and it seems, literally. I'll just keep using fiber metaphors here. And it's the work, it's hard work. It's work that I, maybe I can't speak for every person of African descent, but it's work that many people of African descent do daily. And it's work that requires many people to be at this. So when the recent election occurred and many of my European American friends said, I can't even talk to people in my family anymore, I said, you better learn how to talk to people in your family. Because when we stop talking to each other, then the shit has really hit the fan.
Yeah.
And you guys know where we are right now. I don't need to tell you, right? So, and it's not to ignore it, it's actually to do the work that is required of us. To find ethics and to find empathy and to keep at it. Yeah. Okay. Woo! Remember that you applauded that, ethics and empathy and keeping at it.
It's actually a charge for each of you, not just a responsibility for me. Did you have a question?
You're going to tell us what's in
it. I'm not going to tell you. I decided right here. I'm going to tell you.
It's more fun.
Anyway, thank you. I'm happy to be in the gallery for a little while longer if anybody has, you know, doesn't like to ask big public questions, but you want to ask me something, I'm happy to do a little private thing, too. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.